This is White Oak Worship Center in Blairs, Virginia. Our vision is to provide a place for hurting, broken people to find love, forgiveness, and encouragement. A place to help develop people to spiritual maturity through Bible study, training courses, and small group ministries. A place to help every believer discover their God-given gifts, talents, and callings. It's our desire to strengthen families and to be a blessing to all who come our way. And now, White Oak Worship Center in Blairs, Virginia.
I praise in the valley, I praise on the mountain. I praise when I'm sure I come, I praise when I'm doubting, yes. I praise when I'm numbered, I praise when surrounded. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, yes. Praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, come on. I praise when I feel it. I praise when I don't. Give you glory, we give you honor. How many know these are the days? How many know the day the Lord is coming? How many are excited about that? Some of you say, I'm not excited about that. But as a believer, it's a day of hope. It's a day of deliverance. It's a day that we're just snatched. How many say snatched out of here? You still believe in that? Amen. I still believe in that. How many know we still believe in that? How many know the Lord is coming back one day soon? I don't know when it is, but you know what? I know it's soon. Because I can see the signs around me. These are the days of Elijah. Come on. These are the days of Elijah. Come on. Declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses. Righteousness be restored. Come on. And those are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword. Still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Come on, behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. As the trumpet calls, lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Come on. And out of Zion Hill, salvation comes. Come on, sing it. The dry bones becoming as flesh, yes. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. Come on. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word.
Calvary,
where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. Come on, everyone, let's sing it together. His body and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah's steel and all. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. Come on.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forever. For in the best days we will sing our praise.
Come on.
Oh, Lord.
Third at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven arose again. Yes, oh, triumphant day, wearing your steel, the angels roar of the prize. heaven. Oh, we worship you. We worship you, King of Kings. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There is a name. Hallelujah. But no name is above that name, and that name is Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. I will wait. I will wait on you, Jesus. I will wait on you. What do I do when I'm waiting? I will praise you. I will extol you. I will give you honor. I will think more of you than I will what I'm going through. I will think of your glory. I will remember your promises. I will know that you will receive me into you, Lord. You have received me because of my belief, Father, in your Son, Jesus. Because of my following, because of my obedience to the cross. For my obedience to what Jesus has done, I live for him today. And you will receive me for that very fact, because that's what your word says. Hallelujah. I will wait. Hallelujah. Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew, and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by Christ alone. I will wait for you. Has made a way. Thank you, Jesus. And God himself has paid the price, that all who trust in him today find healing in his sacrifice. Come on. Oh, that all who trust in him today find healing in his sacrifice. I will wait for you through the storm and through the is my delight. Come on. Oh, for I will wait for you. Sure will wait for you. Through the storm and the room of night, I will wait for you. Surely wait for you. For your love, yes, I'm my delight. Oh, I will wait for you. I will wait for you. Through the storm and through the night, I will wait for you. Surely wait for you. For your love is my delight.
I want to introduce to you our special guest today. I want you to know that we love the Woodard family. We appreciate them so very much. They have been with us 11 years now. They pastor the Hispanic church next door. All of our Hispanics that are out there this morning, raise your hands out there, our Hispanic church. Amen. There, a lot of them's working too. The reason they're here today. Amen. The reason they are here today, well, I ought to just let Pastor Kevin tell you the reason that they're here today, but they are raising money for the church in Cuba, and what they are doing, they have cooked today, and for those of you who purchased the tickets, your meal will be ready after service today to pick up. Am I right on that? Amen. If you didn't get a ticket, so sorry. You're like me. I was announcing this Wednesday. I said, you need to get your ticket. We can get your ticket. And they looked at me and said, if you didn't get it Sunday, it's too late. So guess what? I didn't get it. So
this is terrible.
Because them people can cook. Amen. But since they were cooking, they're having church with us today. And of course, Pastor Kevin and I talked about this about a month ago. I said, okay, since y'all have to be with us, you have to preach. So we love this couple. He is his wife teaches Spanish over at Tunstall High School. And Kevin taught Spanish for how many years? 15 years at Tunstall and also at Galileo, right? And the last year that he taught in the public school system, he was Teacher of the Year. Amen? Teacher of the Year. And I told him in the first service this morning, I said, he's been Teacher of the Year every year since he's been here. We love and appreciate him and Gabby. And their precious children. We love them so very much. And would you make him welcome as he comes to break the bread of life this morning? Pastor Kevin Woodard.
Amen. God is good. Amen. Thank you, guys. You may be seated. We're excited this morning. Thank you for everyone that has supported what we're trying to do in the island nation there in the Caribbean. We've been working with churches there. We've been supporting 13 churches there now for probably 2 years or so. And it's getting ready to increase to 21 churches here real soon, looks like. But, you know, many of them are house churches. And our ladies came to us and said, we would like to be able to send shoeboxes to the children in Cuba this year as well as they're doing in Haiti. I said, that's awesome. So we thought this is our first year, so let's go easy. Let's go, you know, light this year just a little bit. I said, why don't we pick the three most needy churches and we'll send to those children. So we talked to the pastors over there, and between those three churches, there was about 60 children that we're going to send boxes for. Well, then the ladies came to me about, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks ago, and I said, how many boxes do you have? They said, 200. I said, 200 boxes. That's awesome. And then I said, well, we've got to get those things shipped. And so we started looking online, and the company that we're going to use, it's amazing how God always shows up right on time. They actually lowered their rates a little bit, so if you send more, the rates go lower. So we've actually found some really good rates. Well, this past Wednesday night, they came in the office, and I said, all right, we're going to send 200 boxes, right? And they said, actually, we have over 500 boxes that have come in. And, yeah. And the food sale today, they sold right at 300 plates of food. Yeah, they've worked hard. They're over there working now still, getting everything ready for you guys. They told me to tell you that there is a little extra. So, Pastor, you might want to go now. I don't know how much. They said it's first come, first served. So, you know, let Pastor go first. And Pastor says, you got the altar call. I'm going over there today. Yeah. So anyway, they're over there working really hard, and we're so thankful for what God has done. Thank you for your help, for supporting this ministry. You've worked so hard, and this church is so giving, and all the boxes that went to Haiti, and now the ones heading down there to Cuba as well. It's a very poor nation, and God has just put on our hearts to be a blessing to that nation, and you're helping with that. So thank you so much. And one last thing I'd like to announce this morning is our trip to Israel coming up next year. We do have the information packets out there on the way out. I was trying to fly away on me. So you'll see them out there. Take these, pray over it. We'd love to see you in Israel next year with us, 2024. You know, don't let the price scare you, because I've been looking at other prices out there and I haven't seen anyone come near our price. And this is gets you from New Jersey to Israel and back. So, and we're also going to do a day trip to Petra, Jordan. That's on there as well. So if you're interested, grab that on the way out. Okay? Amen? Everybody good? Ready for the word today? Amen. If you guys can take your Bibles and turn with me, we're going to be in Psalm 130 in just a few minutes, and then we're going to go to Isaiah 30 after that. Psalm 130, Isaiah 30. Father, again, we come before you, Lord. God, your presence has been so real this morning, so tangible here today, God. Lord, you meet with your people. When your people come together and worship you and praise you, God, you meet in their midst. And Father, today we're asking you to just continue meeting with us, Lord, as we hear your word today, and your word builds our faith and our hope, God. And Lord, may we, God, just learn how to seek you today and to learn to wait upon you today, Father. And God, I pray that as we leave this place, your word will just be ingrained in our minds and our hearts, Father. God, we're here for you today, Lord. God, we're not here to check off our duty sheet, nothing like that. We're here today to say, God, we love you, and we want to know you. We want more of you, more of your presence, more of your goodness, God. I pray you guide my words today. I pray that you will help all of us to understand, Lord, what's being spoken, what's being said, we ask. And God, we thank you, and we praise you, and we love you. We ask these things in Jesus' name, and everyone says, amen, amen. And thank the Hispanic people for being with us today. Last week, we had 77 back there. And God has really blessed and just growing. And Brother Jorge Bravo is in the back here with the headphones on, microphone, speaking to the Hispanics. So I hope he will keep that in mind today as he's translating for them. Amen. God is good. In the book of Luke, chapter 15, we read about the parable of the prodigal son. We're all familiar with that story. And another title for that, maybe instead of calling it the prodigal son, would be called the loving father. And I think we'll understand more as we go through the message today. But it's a very familiar story in a chapter that has two other parables as well. And the first parable is about a lost sheep, and the shepherd leaves the fold and goes and gets that sheep. The shepherd goes and searches for the sheep. The second one is the lost coin. A lady loses a coin, and so she knows how important that coin is. So she takes a broom, she sweeps the house, she cleans up until she finds that coin. The first two parables that we study about, they're explaining to us of how the Lord seeks us out. I really honestly, truly believe that he seeks us out. He gives us the opportunity after opportunity to accept him. He's a loving God, church. And he gave his life so that we, to call us, so we can come in to the fold with him. We had to respond to his call. But the third parable is the one of the prodigal son. We know him as the prodigal son. And this is the one, he goes to his dad and he says, Dad, I want my inheritance now. I want it yesterday. I don't want to wait. I want it now. Basically what he was saying is, Dad, I want you to die so I can get my inheritance and go live my life. That's what he was saying. Now the father, we may say, why would the father, you know, grant his requests? But I think we understand later on as we study. So the father gave him the money, gave him his inheritance, his part of the inheritance. He goes and he blows the money and he lives a big life and everything is supposed to be going all hunky-dory and all great and everything until he runs out of money. And then he loses those friends. He loses those acquaintances. And he gets to the point so low in his life that he's feeding the pigs and he says, well, you know, I guess I could, I'm so hungry. This food I'm giving these pigs looks really good. I could eat this. And he says, but wait just a minute. I got a father back home. And see, here's the thing. As he is sitting there dealing and feeding these pigs and thinking about things, he realizes something. He says, I have a good father back home. I have a father who is a good father who's been good to me. who has provided for me, who has given me what I need, and I can go back and I can be a servant in his house. And so he gets up and he heads back that way. But see, the father knew something. The father knew that the son knew that he needed his father. But the father didn't get up and run to his son to go get his son. He sat there and he waited on his son to come back. And the son realized the goodness of his father. And because he realized that his father was good, he got up and he went back to his father. Romans 2:4 says, don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can you see that his kindness is intended to turn you from your sin? The goodness of God, that's what leads to repentance. It's not always the recognition of our sin that causes us to repent. Many times it's realizing how good the Father is that causes us to repent. And that's what happens in this story. So when we realize the error of our way, what do we need to do? We need to get up and do something about it. We need to get up, dust ourselves off. We need to go to the Father. We need to repent of our ways. We need to fall back into his arms. And we need to sit there and we need to wait on him to hear from him and get in his presence. I truly believe that if you've been a believer for any amount of time, I truly believe, and I think y'all will identify with this as well, that at some point you'll find yourself in a situation where maybe you feel cold or distant, or maybe in a barren land and you're questioning, God, where are you? Where's your presence? I need you. What's happening? Has anyone ever been there before? Okay, good. I'm not alone on this one today. We've all been here. We say, God, where's your presence? And sometimes we get to this point in our lives, in our spiritual walk with the Lord, and it's not intentional. It's not a conscious decision. Sometimes it's just because the cares of this world, the cares of this life, they take precedence. Sometimes they overwhelm, they take control, and they become the forefront of everything that we do. Anybody identify with this today? I know I did. God gave me this message about 4 months ago, and I haven't preached it. Today's the first time I'm preaching this message, so I know it's for someone today. And see, things, they take the forefront, the busyness of life. Then it's almost as if we just go on autopilot and we're just coasting along. We just go with the flow of things. We're running in an exhaustive race so many times. We go through our day. We're not doing anything bad or anything rebellious. We're just busy. And then we know God exists. We respect him, but we're just sacrificing that time. We're not having that time with him that we used to have. We haven't forgotten about him. We're just neglecting our time with him. But then time goes on. Pressures get heavier. Time gets more scarce, and then we get to the point where maybe we're just vulnerable. Maybe we're just too tired. Maybe we just say it's just easier to go with the flow. I don't know if you've been there. I don't know if you're there. We know we need to get on our face, but instead of calling out on the Lord, instead of asking him for strength in time of need, we'll go watch a movie, we'll get on the internet, we'll listen to music, or we'll just fall asleep. And we haven't worked on anything yet. And then we start believing those lies of the enemy and we continue in our busyness and then we slowly forget about the Lord. We know we need to read his word. We know we need to worship. We know we need to praise. We know we need to study. We know we need to talk to him and spend time with him. But we listen to the enemy's voice or we just follow our flesh's desire. And then that leads us to a place of maybe embarrassment with God. Saying, God, I'm so far from you that I don't even know how to come back now. And if I were to come back, I don't even know what to say. I don't even know how to approach your throne. I feel like I am so far from you. I know I'm your child. I'm in your house. I love you. I go to church. I use my gifts and talents for you. But God, my time with you I've been negligent in my time with you. And we get to a point where we say, I just don't even know what to do anymore. And then the emotions, they begin maybe to overwhelm and to overtake. And then we realize that we've been ignoring him. We realize that we've maintained knowledge of him, using gifts and talents for him, but our intimacy with him is gone. We may continue going to church, maybe singing the songs, maybe worshiping with other believers. But sometimes we just forget to get alone with him and wait on him. Maybe maybe you're distanced from him due to a lack of seeking him in decisions that have led to some unwanted or unexpected consequences in your life. And maybe in your eyes, you're just too ashamed to humble yourself and go before him and say, God, I messed up. Now I'm paying consequences for messing up. And Satan can use those things to keep us from getting our time with God. Maybe you're just currently in a battle, and that battle has you anxious, has you nervous or tired, worried, torn, emotionally spent. And it's making you feel so disconnected from the only source that can lift you up and save you. And maybe that's why you're losing your zeal for the Lord. It's in moments like these, in the busyness of life, in the lack of petitioning him and going through all the things that we go through. It's in moments like these that we, the people of God, we have to learn to wait upon the Lord. We have to learn to come back to his presence and simply wait. We got to learn to wait. No distractions, no excuses, no feelings of inferiority. Just coming back and simply waiting on him. Because in the blood of Jesus, we have access to come boldly before the throne of God. That is a lie. That's not something the enemy will lie to you about. He'll say you cannot. But if we're in Jesus Christ, we can come before him. But we have to make a conscious effort to say, I'm coming before your presence. I'm going to disconnect from everything. And I'm just going to sit and I'm going to wait on you. We have to stop. We have to listen for his voice. We have to learn to be patient. Do you hear that? We have to learn to be patient. We are not a patient society. We've lost it. I said this morning, I remember when I was a kid, if you did order something by mail, it would take 6 to 8 weeks to come in. And then by the time it came in, you forgot you ordered it. But nowadays you order and in 8 hours it's at your house. And see, that's how we have become. And we're so busy. And we gotta do this. And we gotta do that. And yes, we trust God, and yes, we believe in him, and yes, we know him, but we're not waiting on him. And we are getting in trouble by depending on our own strength instead of saying, God, I simply stop everything, and I just wait. See, in the upper room, they were told to wait for the promise. They had one command, wait. We have no record in the Bible of anything that was said or anything that was done. We have no record of any of these things. I'm sure that their minds were full of all the things they had to do. There are people sitting here today saying, when I get out of church today, I got to go home and wash these clothes. I got to go home. Got to go to the store and get this. See, what's the thing? We come to church and we're so busy and we're so wound up. And guys, we're all there. I'm there too. This message preaches to me just as it does to you. But what we have to understand and say is, look, that stuff I've got to do it, but nothing is more important. Nothing is more important than me waiting on the Lord. In the upper room, I'm sure they had things to do. Maybe they had to fetch water to wash clothes. Maybe they had to go kill the calves and prepare food. Maybe they had to pay the bills and the men had to go catch some fish. I don't know. Okay? They had things that they were doing, but none of that was more important than simply waiting on the Lord. Simply waiting on him because God had given the promise. He said, wait, and I will send the promise. See, sometimes we can be like Elijah. Elijah had that huge victory. The prophets of Baal, you remember the story of Mount Carmel. And he had that huge victory, but because of Jezebel, he gets all scared, and he runs this cave, and he gets in a cave, and he hides in there. And God says, Elijah, what are you doing here? And Elijah did not answer the question. Elijah began to complain and tell God what was wrong with everything going on and all these prophets and all this stuff and I'm the only one left and blah, blah, blah. And God's like, no, no, Elijah, come out of the cave. And Elijah at that point doesn't come out of the cave. He goes to the entrance of the cave. And he's at the entrance of that cave and God sends a mighty wind and the wind is so strong that it breaks the rocks, but God was not in the wind. Then God sends an earthquake and Elijah's seeing that earthquake. He's witnessing it, but God was not in the earthquake. And then God sends a fire and Elijah sees the fire. He sees the fire of God, the power of God. But God's not in the fire either. And then he says, Elijah, come out of the cave. Elijah steps out. This time he steps out and he says, what are you doing here, Elijah? And Elijah begins to tell him. He's honest. And then the Bible says it was a still, small voice that God revealed himself to Elijah. Guys, I believe in the earthquakes. I believe in the wind. I love to see those services when the fire is falling. But when you want God to reveal himself to you, you got to get away from all the noise. And you got to get on your face and you got to wait. And you got to say, God, wait. I wait on you. I wait to hear your will. I wait to hear your word. Amen. See, so many people, they're in the cave. They don't want to come out. It's a cave of depression, a cave of why me, a cave of poor me. It's a cave of sadness, rejection, beaten down, fear, worry, doubt, temptation, complaints. And God is saying, come out of the cave and let me talk to you. Come out and just simply wait on me. Let me reveal myself to you. Guys, we get so caught up in the things that are going on in our lives and we start worrying and we get depressed and we get down and we're like, poor me. And we're going to God and say, oh God, why? And we're in that cave and we're just trying to cry out and we're not giving ourselves a chance to listen to him and wait on him. Psalm 130, if you can find that with me, please. This will sound very familiar. We just sang this song today. Psalm 130, verses 1 through 6. It says, the psalmist says, out of the depths have I cried unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If thou, Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul doth wait. And in his word do I hope. My soul waiteth for the Lord more than they that watch for the morning. I say more than they that watch for the morning. Out of the depths of despair, he said, I cried unto the Lord. See, we have to learn to cry unto the Lord. We get to that point of despair and say, God, I need you. It sounds like the things we've been talking about this morning, the psalmist understood. He was in the depths of despair and he cried out to God. Sometimes it's because of life itself or decisions that we make and we feel like we're in despair. But we have to learn, as the psalmist teaches us here, to cry out to the Lord and say, God, be attentive to my cry. Lord, I'm crying out to you. I need you to hear. And the word of God teaches us that he will incline his ear. When we speak to him, he'll incline that ear. He will hear us. But it's when we separate from everything and disconnect and just seek his face and wait for him. Verse 3 is a powerful verse. It says, if thou, Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? It's a prayer of repentance. The psalmist understands God is the one who forgives. He says, I come to you, I cry out to you, and I repent before you. And in doing that, now he's gonna say, now I'm waiting upon you. But the thing that's incredible is he says, if you, O Lord, were to keep a record of my sins, how could I ever survive? How many of you love that God is forgetful when it comes to our sins? He separates us from those sins as far as the east is from the west. He buries them in the deepest sea. And if he's forgetful, shouldn't we be forgetful as well? He has forgiven us. He has washed us. He has cleansed us into the power of Jesus Christ. He's the only one powerful enough. The only one that can save. Aren't you glad we have an advocate with the Father? We have a defense attorney right there, representing us before the Father. Thank God he doesn't keep a record of our sins. Thank God he doesn't keep a record of our sins when we confess them before him. He covers them. He justifies us. You know what justified means? Declared innocent. Just as if I had never sinned. See, justification's instant. You put your faith in him, you're justified. Sanctification is a process. And we're all being sanctified. Amen? But justification, put our faith in him. Verse 4, he said, but you offer forgiveness that we might learn to fear you. You forgive. I recognize who you are. I recognize who I am. You're the creator. I am the sheep of your pasture. You are the one that forgives me. We have to understand that, guys. And verse 5 is so powerful. I wait for the Lord. my soul doth wait. And in his word, in his what? His word do I hope. I wait. I simply wait. I cry unto him. I repent. He forgives. Now I wait. And I think we need to learn to wait on the Lord. When we're away from God or when we're facing a major decision in our life, it can be hard for us to hear God's voice. But we have to learn to wait. We've got to learn. If we don't wait, we're going to rely on our own intellect. And if we rely on our own intellect, we're going to fall flat on our face. When Joshua and the children of Israel were told to conquer the promised land, they come in, they conquer the towns and the cities. There was a group called the Gibeonites. And the Gibeonites saw what they were doing, and the Gibeonites said, we don't want to be destroyed. So the Gibeonites, what they did is they put on old clothes, they put a bunch of dirt and dust on their face, and they grabbed a bunch of old moldy bread. And they came up to Joshua and they said, we come from a faraway land. Bunch of liars are from down the road. We come from a faraway land. Please have mercy on us. See, what happened was Joshua said, okay, we will have mercy on you. What they had to understand was when you entered into a covenant with someone back in that day, if you're in covenant with that person, well, their enemies now become your enemies. So Joshua actually committed or entered into a covenant where Israel now had to fight enemies they had no business fighting because he got into this covenant. But here's what happened. The Bible says that the Israelites examined their food. They saw the moldy bread. It looked at them. They said, yeah, they're probably from a long way away. They examined it. But then the word says, but they did not consult the Lord. If they had simply waited and consulted the Lord, if we would learn to wait and consult the Lord, how many blessings have we missed out on? How many consequences are we paying for right now? Because we didn't learn to wait and say, God, guide my steps. This was their mistake. They didn't consult the Lord. We have to learn to ask before we act. Before entering into business deals with others, before marrying someone, before buying a house, before accepting a job, we're supposed to be a people of prayer. We're supposed to be a people that gets on their face. But the church of God today is full of prayerlessness, a lack of prayer. We're not seeking God. We think we know more than God. I said this morning, you know, a bunch of teenagers, get them together. Teenagers always know more than we know, but they think they do anyway. And we're the same way with God sometimes. We feel like we know what's best. Guys, if we are men and women of prayer, we should not want what he doesn't want us to have. We should only want what he has for us, what he wants us to have. Maybe we need to just get up early and seek his counsel for the day. Say, God, you know what lies ahead of me today. You know what's waiting for me today. I seek your counsel. I seek your wisdom. In Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21, I want to read that, and then we're going to jump around some in this chapter today. But Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21, God is talking to his people. They were trying to depend upon Egypt. He talks to his people, and he says, your own ears will hear him. This is the prophet speaking to them. Right behind you, a voice will say, this is the way you should go, whether to the right or to the left. And I'm going to read you a verse from Isaiah 42, 16. You can just listen to it. I will lead blind Israel down a new path, guiding them along an unfamiliar way. Here's the thing. God is saying, if you seek my counsel, if you wait on me, if you let me guide your steps, there will be a voice inside of you that's going to lead you, is going to direct you. It will tell you go to the right. It will tell you go to the left. I am with my people and I want to guide them and lead them. Jesus said, my sheep know my voice and they follow me. He already has the solution. He already has the solution. All we got to do is seek him and say, God, what is it? What's your plan for my life? Whatever it may be, you may be going through a trial with your health right now. Wait upon him. You may be needing a job right now. Wait upon him. Maybe your children are far from the Lord. Wait upon him. Get in his presence and wait upon him. Now go to verse 1 of chapter 30 of Isaiah. Isaiah 30, verse 1. It says, woe to the rebellious children. God is speaking to his people. Woe as a curse. Woe to the rebellious children, says the Lord, that take counsel, but not of me. And that cover with a covering, but not of my spirit. That they may add sin to sin. That walk to go down into Egypt and have not asked at my mouth. He says, you're not asking for my advice. You're trying to do it on your own. You're trying to be strong. You're trying to make your decisions. I want you to seek me, but you will not. You would not. That's what he's saying. You're not seeking my counsel. You're seeking it from everybody else, but not from me. Jump down to verse 15. The chapter shifts here. Chapter 30, verse 15. For thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel. This is what God says to his people. Listen, church. In returning and rest shall ye be saved. In quietness and in confidence shall be your strength. But then he says, and ye would not. He says, if you come to me, you return to me, and you rest, you stop what you're doing, you get quiet before me, you stop the busyness. See, we don't know how to do that, church. Let's just be honest. We don't know how to do that. We don't know how to turn YouTube off. We don't know how to turn the phone off or leave it in another room. We don't know how to think to stop thinking about the job or stop thinking about all these other things. We don't know how to do it. We've got to learn to do it. He says, turn it off and rest. Turn it off and rest. Stop running. Stop the busyness. Stop trying to get a word all the time. Stop trying to get confirmation all the time. Stop calling all the pastors and leaving them voicemails to see if they have a word for you. Come into my presence and wait up on me. Say, God is saying, I don't want a word. I don't want you to give a word. I don't want prophecy. I don't want you falling out at the altar. This is not a time for the fire or the earthquake or the wind. It's a time for the still small voice. Those things are fine. They're great. But there are times that you got to shut it all down and get in his presence alone with him and wait on him. Wait on his direction. He says, in quietness and returning and rest, you'll be saved. In quietness and in confidence shall be your strength, but you would not. Verse 16, he says to them, but you said no. I'm telling you, come, stop everything and rest. But you said no. And you said, for we will flee upon horses. He says, I'm here. I'm waiting on you. Wait on me. I want you to wait on me, but you would not. You got on those fast horses. You're all the time running with the busyness of life. We do it. I'm guilty. You're guilty. Our kids have sports. Our kids have school. Our kids have projects. Maybe your grandchildren need your help. We're busy. I get it. But we can't use it as an excuse not to seek his face. If you will do what you want to do. If you want to go to a buffet, you're going to go because you want to. If you're going to go to the movies, you'll go because you want to. If you want to get to know him, you will make the time. You will wait upon him. You will wait. We will wait upon him. He wants to fill us with confidence and strength and give us the victory. But sometimes we would not. And we got to say, God, forgive me for that. They wanted to ride those wild horses. They had to go. They couldn't wait. God says, you can't wait, then I can't help you. It's time for you to stop everything you're doing and listen. Return, rest, quiet confidence, trust me. I think we need to have a waiting service in church. I think there shouldn't be any talking, no falling out, just coming and being quiet. And saying, God, you know my need. And God, I need you. God, I don't know what to do. You direct me and guide my steps. But only you can do it, God. So we forget about that sometimes. And that's what he wants to work in us. We need to say, God, I'll wait on you. I return to you. I need you now. I need strength. I need confidence. I need my faith to build up. And the only place I can go is in your presence. So here I am. We need to do it. If we wait upon him and seek his counsel, I want you to notice what verse 18 says in Isaiah 30. This is powerful. It says, and therefore will the Lord wait that he may be gracious unto you. What's he saying? The Lord is waiting on me to wait on him. Do you see it? He said, if you will learn to wait on me, see, I'm sitting here waiting on you. The verse says, blessed are those that wait on the Lord. Blessed are those. God is saying, I want to bless you. I'm waiting on you to wait on me. When are you going to start waiting? Because I want to bless you. I have what you need. I have your answer. I have your peace. I have your solution. But wait. We have to be willing enough to say, Kevin, just shut up. Kevin, just hush. And say, I'm just going to wait. I'm just going to wait. I'm going to pray in quietness right now at this time. When we stop working, he starts working. See, the whole key to the upper room was to wait. They had to wait for 10 days. We can't wait 10 minutes sometimes. I'm just being honest. They waited 10 days, and they did it. And they said, we'll wait. And God sent the power of the Holy Spirit upon them, who is with us to this day. When you stop and say, here I am, I really need your help. I need your wisdom to draw close to you. I need to do your will. He acts for the people who wait on him. We all know the verse in Isaiah 40, 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall, what shall happen? They'll renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. If you're tired and you feel like you're going to faint, stop everything you're doing. Get in his presence and say, God, I just wait. I just wait. Sometimes we go to his presence asking him for things. Sometimes we just need to go wait. He's waiting on us to wait on him. If you're not seeking him, then wait upon him. If you're away from him, get in his presence and wait on him. Let's consult him. Let's ask before we act. We need his will in our lives. Psalm 130, the last two verses, last three verses there. Notice what he says. My soul yearns for the Lord among those longing for the dawn. Those longing for the dawn. He repeats it here because he's saying, I don't give up hope. I'm not giving up hope. It's like those sentries of old, they used to stay up all night, and they were the guards that just guarded the towns all night long. They couldn't wait for the dawn to come because they wanted to be done. They wanted to go rest. I don't know what you're going through right now. Maybe you're going through the night and you can't wait for that dawn to come. I'm just going to tell you right now, wait. How long do you have to wait? As long as it takes. It might be a day, it might be a year, it might be a decade. I don't know. I stated in first service this morning, we have an aunt that we prayed for her for years and years and years and years. God save her, God save her. And honestly, we thought at times that it's hopeless. You shouldn't think that way, but sometimes, you know how you get in the flesh sometimes, being honest. But you know what? 5 or 6 years ago, she told us, she said, I gave my life to Christ. And she said, I'm serving him now. She said, I can't do much, so I can't sing. She said, I sound awful when I try to sing. She said, I can't play no instrument. I'm from the mountains, you know, we all speak all hibbly up there. And she said, but I can cook. And boy, can she cook. She married an Italian, so he taught her how to cook really good. But anyway, so she said, I have joined in our church the ministry that cooks for people who have lose loved ones. And she said, I've been cooking for that. And she said, I'm using my gifts and talents now for the Lord. I said, amen, yes, you are. She just told me that like a month and a half ago, 2 months ago. So wait on him. See, he repeats it here. He says, longing for the dawn, those longing for the dawn. He says it two times because he's saying, I don't give up hope. Despite what I'm seeing, despite the circumstance, I will not give up hope. And then in verse 7, I like this. He says, let Israel hope in the Lord. Let Israel hope in the Lord. Here's what you have to understand. The word hope In the Bible, doesn't mean like we say in English, well, I hope it won't rain today. No, there's uncertainty in that statement. When you use the word hope in the Hebrew, in the Bible, Hebrew or Greek, it's synonymous with waiting for, hoping for. And hope is the same thing as faith. He's saying here, I'm waiting for the dawn. I'm waiting on you. I'm hoping in you. My faith is in you. And come what may, I know that you are greater. I know that you are bigger. I know that you have the solution. I know you're guiding my steps, and I will simply wait on you. Let Israel hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is mercy, and with him is plenteous redemption, and he shall redeem Israel from all his iniquities. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. I want you to stand to your feet. It's beautiful to think about how we hope in the Lord, how we wait upon him. I want to read two verses to you. I want you just to listen to these verses. Please don't get distracted. Listen to Isaiah 64:4. For since the world began, no ear has heard and no eye has seen a God like you who works for those who wait for him. Psalm 27:14 says, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. I ask you to just close your eyes for a few moments this morning. We have to learn to wait. This is something that I've had to live through and work through, as many of you have. And this morning, I think God is just calling out to his people, wait on me. The world is in chaos right now. There's uncertainty everywhere you turn. That's why we come into his presence and we simply wait. He'll guide our steps. He'll direct our steps. That's what he wants to do. And he's waiting on us to wait on him. I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know your trial. I don't know your circumstance. I don't know if you're in the middle of the night waiting for the dawn to arise. I don't know if you're battling for your health. I don't know if you're battling for your children. I don't know if you're battling in your finances. I don't know if you lack faith. I don't know if you're afraid. I don't know if you're up in that cave somewhere saying, poor me, poor me, poor me. But come out of that cave and let him speak to you. Here's what I'd like to do this morning. And you might find this a little funny, but God really ministered to me with this. I said, God, I just want to take time to wait. I said, but Sunday morning, so many people are in a hurry to get out. They want to, just being honest, they want to get to the restaurants. And then that's when the Holy Spirit reminded me, said, Kevin, don't worry about that. There's food prepared for them over there. That food's not going anywhere. I was like, God, you're right. Why am I even going to doubt about that? So this morning, I'm going to open up this altar. And if you just need to wait on the Lord this morning, then you should just come down here and fill up this altar. Let's just take a few moments. Lee's going to sing that song again, Psalm 130. And we're going to wait on the Lord this morning. We're going to wait. The altar is open. This morning, it filled up with people that came down here and they just said, God, I'll wait for you. But find a spot. I'm just going to pray as the Lord leads me this morning. But find a spot and let's get on our face. It's like I said earlier, maybe you know you're not doing anything bad or rebellious, and you know you're not. God knows that too, but where's the intimacy? We live in a busy, busy, busy society. And we're all guilty. But this morning we just need to say, God, I wait upon you. I wait upon you. Just take some time and talk to him this morning as Lee ministers in song.
Hallelujah. Out of the depths I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew. And hear my cry for mercy, Lord.
cry out to him, church. Just cry out to him. Tell him what's on your heart.
To count my sinful ways. How could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone.
While I'm waiting, I rely on your word. I rely on your word. I rely on your word that lifts me up, that encourages me, that gives me strength from day to day. I rely on you, Father. I wait. I trust. I believe. I have faith. I'm not going to doubt. No more doubting. No more worry. I trust.
So your hope in God alone. Take courage in his power to save. Completely and forever one by Christ emerging from the grave.
I will wait for you.
I will wait for you. I will wait for you on your word. I will rely. I will wait for you. Surely.
Until my soul is satisfied, however long that takes, God, I will wait. I will wait. I will be in your word. I will trust you. Father, this morning, God, we come before you, Jesus, to say, God, that we wait. We wait on you. We wait on your glory. We wait on your presence, Father. We wait on your will, Jesus. God, we repent, Father, for the times that we've been so busy, not intentionally, God, but Father, we have been negligent. We have to admit, Father, God, now we just come before to say, Lord, we're sorry, we repent, God, and we just wait. We wait, we wait, we wait in your presence. Parents here, moms and dads, you're waiting for your children to come into the fold. You keep waiting on the Lord. You grab hold of him today. You grab hold of his promises. You grab hold of his word and you wait on him. Let him figure it out. It's not for us to figure out. It's for him to lead us and to guide us and to show us. Maybe there's some grandparents here today that are just saying, oh, my children are lost. My grandchildren are lost. Pray for them this morning. Lift them up. Lift them up this morning. Call out their names to him. Say, God, I wait on you. Maybe you're going through something with your health right now, a trial in your health. High blood pressure, diabetes, abnormalities in your body. Wait on him. Wait on him. Get in his presence and say, Lord, I wait. I wait. I wait. Hallelujah. You sing that chorus again, I will wait.
I will wait for you on your word. I will rely. I will wait for you. Surely wait for you till my soul is satisfied.
I will wait.
I will wait for you. I will wait for you through the storm. And through the night, I will wait for you, surely wait for you, for your love is my delight. I will wait for you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift those hands to heaven this morning. Lift those hands to heaven. Say, God, I wait. God, I wait. I surrender my will to you, Jesus. I surrender my will to you, God. I surrender what I want to do, my plans, my purpose, my desires. God, I surrender it to you right now. And God, I will wait. I will wait for you to open that door. I will wait upon you, God. I'm no longer going to get in front of you, Father. I'm coming out of the cave today, God. Oh, Lord, the depression will not keep me in the cave anymore. The anxiety won't keep me in the cave anymore. The fear will not keep me. The worry, the doubt, they will not keep me in the cave anymore, Father. I'm coming out, Lord. I've seen your power. I know your glory. Oh, God, I know you are powerful. I know you are omnipotent. I know there is no one greater than you. But Father, right now, I need to hear your voice. I need the still small voice in my heart, in my life, in my home. Hallelujah. Just ask him today. I would like to, while you're ministering and still worshiping here, I would like to ask the youth to come forward. If you're in here, youth, we should come up here at the altar and balcony down here. If you're part of the youth group, the youth of this church, just come forward. We're going to pray for you guys this morning. It's been on my heart since yesterday to really pray for you. Some of you are already up here. The rest of you are coming. Here they come from the balcony. Come on down, guys. Hallelujah. Let's praise the Lord for these youth, guys. Hallelujah. If we can make a place right here for the youth to come. You guys can just come stand right here. And I want all the adults, we're going to come together. We're going to pray for these youth today. Because how many know we have to be the example for them to know how to wait on the Lord? The society that they live in, the culture they live in, doesn't even resemble what you and I grew up in. And they face so much. And the pressures mount so heavily on them. And there's a culture of tolerance now. It's a culture of just accepting everything. And honestly, guys, there's nothing left to the imagination of many of our youth. But let's this morning minister to them. Young guys, young ladies, I want to encourage you now. Learn how to wait on the Lord. Learn how to do it now. Listen to that voice of reason. Listen to your parents, your grandparents. Get godly advice. Because you're facing so much stuff right now, but there's so much more you're going to face. Our youth need Jesus. They need the strength of the Holy Spirit. And I just want to pray for them today. And adults, I'm going to ask you, just pray for them. Pray, maybe your child is not here, but pray for them like they were your own children. Because they need to learn to wait upon the Lord. Maybe you worry about that future spouse. Just wait on God. He has the perfect one for you. Don't rush. Don't get ahead of his plans. Maybe you're saying, well, what's my job going to be? What am I going to do? Wait upon the Lord. He'll show you. He'll lead you. He'll guide you. Do y'all believe that, church? Let's pray for them this morning. Father, I thank you, God, for the youth of this church, of this God, that you have blessed us with, God. Father, you're such a wonderful group of young people. And God, I believe that their hearts, Father, truly do want to know you and follow you. And God, they're being molded right now, Lord, as they're growing up and they're in church and they're hearing the word. And Pastor Daniel is teaching that word to them, God. And I just thank you for that, Father. I thank you, God, that you're guiding their steps. I thank you, Father, that you're protecting them and your presence is with them, God. And I ask you, Lord, Father, for this group right here. Oh, Jesus, from this group right here, Lord. And those who are part of our church, maybe they're not even here today, God, but the youth who are part of this church, God, even in those who are in their 20s, Father, oh Lord, as they're growing up and maturing and learning and seeking the things, seeking spouses and seeking jobs and wanting an education and what to do and where to go and all of those things, God, I pray, Lord, that they learn to wait upon you, Father. Oh God, you called young Samuel, Father, when he was just a lad, you began to call him, God. Lord, you called David when he was young, Father. Oh Lord, you called Josiah to be king when he was 9 years old, Father. Oh Lord, if you did it then, you can do it today as well, Father. And I ask you, God, in the name of Jesus, let this youth know the power of your Holy Spirit. Oh God, let them walk in the power and the strength of your Holy Spirit, the power and the might of who you are, God. Lord, may they know you, God, as never before. May these youth, God, be radical for you, Lord. God, not going with with the flow, not going with the world, Lord, but Father, setting standards up to say, I will not bow down to this world. I will not settle for the ideas of this world. I stand upon the Word of God. I want to be holy. I want to live a holy life, and I want to please you, God. Father, you have raised them up for such a time as this, and Lord, we'll pass the baton on to them someday. But Father, I pray, Lord, for them. Protect them, keep them, Lord. I ask in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Oh, church, just worship the Lord. I will wait, I will wait. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we worship you, God. We worship you, God. We worship you, God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, God. Touch them, Lord. Touch them, Lord. Hallelujah. Adults, they're going to follow our example. Let's be that example to them. Examples of faith. Examples of how to wait on the Lord. Of how to hear His voice. Of how to follow Him. Hallelujah. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Can you sing it again for us, Lee?
I will wait for you, I will wait for you through the storm and through the night. I will wait for you, surely wait for your love is my delight. I will wait for you.
Sing it to the Lord today. Tell Him. Don't tell me, tell Him. On your word, I will rely. Young people, learn to rely on His word. It's all that's going to get you through sometimes.
Surely wait for you till my soul is satisfied.